Hello. So as Antje said, my name is something like that. So that's the international phonetics, I think, primarily for Western Europeans. So it's Irene Vlachou. You can call me anything in a version of Irene, it's fine. Don't worry. Anyway, so I am basically a Greek typeface designer, but today I came to talk to you about variable fonts, which is my new passion, and I'm a big groupie, and at the same time, I'm trying to be a developer and make my own variable fonts. So I hope you didn't have enough of it already. So the title of my talk, because I had to have one, of course, it was Movable Type Volume 2, and as pretentious as it sounds, I would like to be able to change it today to this thing that sounds even more pretentious. So this still refers to variable fonts, and do believe that the dogs today had a special place in this conference. So yes, circus dogs, variable fonts, same thing. I'll tell you later why. So this is how more or less I'm going to proceed. These are the parts of my talk, but because who wants to remember that, maybe you should prefer to remember symbols. So it's going to be a microphone, a dog, some cowboys, variable fonts, a case study, and then a coffee break. So, variable fonts and me. This is my first commercial variable fonts that I produced at the beginning of this year. It's a sans serif typeface by Typographers that had been released a few months before as a static font. So we were quite lucky in a sense that we were designing this thing while variable fonts were announced in Warsaw. So that was pretty convenient for us. But of course, I mean, I don't know about others, but I don't think this is the first thing that you jump upon, I mean, to start making a commercial font. So you do some experiments. And at the time that the variable fonts were announced, I was involved in this project. It was the Documenta 14 in Castle in Athens. And I was designing the Greek font for the identity of the conference. So at the time, there was discussion about what is going to be the contrast of the Greek script, the Greek typeface. So we decided to go a bit further and say, forget the Latin. The Greek script doesn't have to follow the Latin, so let's do something exactly the opposite. So for me, it was a good chance with the variable fonts to experiment when it comes to the stress of the glyphs. So this was the first animation that I did using variable fonts. The first letter is an O, a Latin O, and the second one is a Greek omicron, which is 99% of the times is a composite glyph, so it's exactly the same. But that was an experiment of 10 historic typefaces, so that contains a Times, a Garamond, a Minion even, I think it also has a Helvetica somewhere. So the basic, most influential, I guess, typefaces, and how the contrast changes from the Latin to the Greek. So this is how the design has been, and that actually for me it was using this animation was a much more easier way to explain that the Greek doesn't actually have to follow the Latin. And on top of that, I did an experiment of this 10-axis typeface for these four Greek letters, to prove another point that the Greek type design has, that the Greek letters, they don't have to have the same stress between them. So I'm not telling you to do whatever you want when you design Greek. I mean, there are basically some rules, but still it's pretty flexible when it comes to stress. So yes, my experiments were more or less that. Of course, I did some silliness that everybody does, because you don't need to do type, you know, you can do beetles and heart shapes and silly stuff. I think it's part of the process, and it should be part of the process. And in this new thing, I used some old tools that I already knew, and of course, some new stuff came into my life, like TTX and font tools and robot that I finally managed to learn a tiny bit of Python and not making a mess. And of course, testing fonts, axis praxis, everything was going a bit wild. So just I would like to go just a tiny bit back to my Movable Type Volume 2 title and explain you why is that. So after horses, beetles and owls, I would like to introduce you to the chapter of the Font Wars and talk about two cowboys. For the people that are a bit older than me, probably they kind of have seen these covers in magazines that it was about in the 80s, that companies, Apple and Microsoft, are against Adobe, and there is a big fight about quadratic and cubic outlines. It's TrueType against PostScript, and this is something that is not only for geeks, they're something that people kind of know. The users kind of have to, they're divided, and they have to choose one or the other kind of outlines and fonts. And on top of that, the competition goes even further. And for the first time, we have the dynamic fonts. I mean, the first time for much more massive use. And 1991, Adobe introduces the multiple master. And Apple, 2 years later, the DX model. So this is the first time after hundreds of times, I guess, that we all of a sudden have fonts that they are more than they used to be. So before, the simple static font, we just had a digitized piece of metal type, more or less, and all that has contained have all the inflexibilities that the metal type applies. And now we have all this new format that they were dynamic fonts, and we don't refer to the font as one static state. It has not even multiple states, it has a continuum of states. So it can be many things and has almost infinite possibilities. So it is a real dynamic tool. And I was lucky enough to find this forum that this has been survived again and revived again in the Google groups. It's from 1993. And there is the description of Charles Bigelow about the variable font, about the DX font. Sorry for that. And has some really fascinating description, which is mainly about the glyph substitution that DX model was able to do. The ligatures, the sources, things that they're implemented now in OpenType. So, and he described them as a very clever trained circus dog that does tricks than a simple font. So this is a very, I think, nice way to describe a dynamic font to a graphic designer, to a web developer, to my mom, I guess. You know, like a simple description that this does just a bit more tricks than the other one. That's what it is. So if I want to sum it up, it would be something as silly as that. It was also really interesting to find this quote from the same forum when Charles Bigelow tries to describe what is this thing inside the font that makes it smarter, and he describes as a computer program. And that if you have followed discussions about variable fonts in conferences and things, you see that this is an actual thing that people are trying to explain, trying to see how it's going to be, how all these parameters are going to be in the font, and how the user is going to access them. So it is a very interesting thing that everybody, even back then, sees them in the same kind of way. So the dynamic fonts, the DX model and the multiple master model, even the variable fonts, they are complex models for fonts. And they're really complex for the users to understand how to use them, for developers how to develop them and make them. And these two models, they didn't really succeed. And I presume that one of the reasons was because of the font wars. And that's so it was a war between the corporations that actually led for the death of the two cowboys and their new smart tool. So we move 20 years later in 14th of September 2016, a holiday for the variable fonts, when the previous two cowboys have met two more new American friends, and Apple, Google and Microsoft this time, and all together they submit this proposal for OpenType 1.8, so the variable fonts. And it's an extremely amazing result, to be honest, and that in these 2 years we have all these things have happened about variable fonts. We have 93 articles, we have talks, an international conference, we have 100 plus variable fonts already. We have four websites that you can showcase, test, and see your fonts. All the main font editors actually support them. All the latest modern browsers support them. There are manuals to implement them, and there are forums and things that people discuss. And least but not the last, Hoi. The next guys are going to talk about us, hopefully. So the only thing that I found that it was missing from this era compared to 20 years ago was this amazing thing. Back in the 95, there was a fan club of the DX fonts. It wasn't just for the DX fonts, it was the Quickdraw fan club, which was started by Kenneth Truman in 1995 and was on for 2 years. So this Quickdraw fan club was doing everything that websites, conferences, online manuals, type drawers, anything that we have, Twitter, Instagram does today. So it had showcases, font of the month, and under that, all the variable fonts would be released, and the DX fonts that would be released, and you have notes on what does what. And also there were information about which applications and were technical savvy, and they would support them. And on top of that, there were two forums, one forum for users and one forum for developers, that I managed to track down Kenneth, and Kenneth said that each of them had at least 1,000 subscribers. So that was an ongoing conversation of how this format would stand, if it could survive, information that you want to ask, there was a place to do that. And of course there was a clubhouse, which was like a tree house. You know, it has this amazing description, says, look up, way in the trees, do you see it? And so there is this kind of ambitious and excitement about the format, which unfortunately died at the time. And Kenneth, the creator of the website, he was extremely disappointed. When I contacted him and asked him to tell me an opinion about what does he think that's going to happen with the variable fonts this time, he said, probably nothing. He was extremely pessimistic because I guess he had put most of his life into this thing. So part two, the real life. It was all very romantic, and some case studies now how these things are not so romantic. So as I said before, Protipo was the first commercial variable font released by Typographers, and it was a good example to make a variable font, I think, because it was intended for information design, apps, and infographics. So there are the times that this is the place that you really need some fine tuning and some extra options and styles. Protipo had these funny shapes changing by using the feature variation thing that I explained in a previous talk, and it's kind of a boring topic anyway. So that was my first experiment of how this glyphs suits inside the font. And you do need that, and this is not a new thing in typography. We do have that for many years when we have a text style and a display style. So you would need some different design for specific character for the euro sign. And when it becomes really bold, you cannot maintain these two lines, so you change it to one. But this information is stored now inside the font, so the font dynamically changes to the other side. So this was the numbers of the weight axis. So when the weight axis was more than 400, the dollar and the currency symbol would change to no line, to two lines, two vertical lines. And after 440, the yen and the euro and the Q would follow, etc., etc. So that was my first hardcore session with variable fonts and how do we code these things. Because I didn't tell you, I'm not a coder. I have no clue about coding, and that couldn't become straightforward from a font editor. So the second project that we decided to push a bit further forward was Portada, which is the serif counterpart of Typographers. But the problem with this one, it was that it was never meant to be a variable font, and that was released in 2016, and it has a text and a display size. And as you can see, the display weights were a bit more than the text weights, which that led to many problems, but I'll talk about that a bit later. So because of the display and the text styles, I decided to have, apart from the weight axis, that was an obvious one, to have an optical axis. The optical axis, I think that from the registered axis, is the most interesting of all. Optical axis defines the differences between small sizes text and big sizes text. So that could be from text to display or vice versa. So these are the weights, the two axes, weight and let's see how the weight axis was working. So this is how the weight axis works for the textiles. Is it? No, that's for the display. So it goes from 100 to 1,000. You don't have to remember these values, but this is more or less the scale of this thing. And the optical axis was doing that. So you see in the smaller sizes, when it says 14, it goes to much wider spacing because it's meant to be used for text, and the contrast is lower than the display. So this is not something that you can easily see, especially in typeface like that, but I guess you can see it here. But it's extremely interesting axis. The things that you can do with that and the things that you can hide, more or less. So as I mentioned before, Portada wasn't meant to be a variable font, and making it was a bit of a challenge, especially because I wanted to mix the text and the display that never meant to be together. So the problems that I had was, first of all, the character set. It wasn't compatible. The text weights had much larger character set than the displays. Of course, the outlines weren't compatible because that was two different subfamilies, so no one thought about designing them compatibly. There were design inconsistencies because there were different designs for the text, for some characters compared to the display. And of course, there was the problem that I saw you before, the weight range, that display had three weights more than the text. So what do you do with that? So of course, feature variations, the old nice trick was put in action. And this is the italic, that this is the text weights, and it goes display, and when it goes display, it becomes round. So this is how the user, when it slides the optical size axis, you will see this kind of difference in these characters. The same here, that's a display, back to text. So these are tricks that you don't have to actually do anything. Smart browsers like Safari, in a sense, when you actually go over the 36 points, it's going to flip directly to the display sizes and directly to this kind of design. So this is not even something that you need to control if you don't want to. The same thing with here, when the 4 changes, and it's a bit more complicated things with the ligature feature. Oh. When feature variation gets involved with a ligature feature, and that can be really ugly way to solve it. And of course, there were cases like the G that I decided more or less to leave it as it was. So to have this movement inside the letter, that it wasn't, of course, a very official decision, but I thought it was funny, one character to go between display and optical, display and text, to just move instead of flipping instantly. So this is not a feature variation. So going back to this ugliness and how this had to be coded, there was discussion 6 days ago, I think, when it was in GitHub, and you realized that the code is a bit daft, and my God, how do we do these things? And I said, I found this extremely silly solution, and used common news was that my eyes are bleeding with this thing, which, yep, thanks. I mean, I know it's ugly, but yeah, that's unfortunately, that's how it works. And I must say that for me it wasn't always easy to understand where this thing is going to be and how am I going to actually code this thing. So whenever I have problems, which is very common, I go back to draw Cartesian scales, drawings to see where these chains are going to become. And this is a 3-axis feature variation that was, you see this purple box is somewhere between the slant and the weight and becomes a mess. So it's extremely difficult to understand what you are doing and when these things are going to jump and how they interact. So because I have problem with that, I'm pretty sure that the users are going to have problem with that. So in a presentation a couple of months ago, I showed this thing, hopefully for people to understand what I was doing. And this is Superpolator, an app that we use to see interpolation, and it's not based on the GX model, but it's pretty good to visualize what we're doing. So you see the cursor moves upwards to the width axis. So whenever it goes wider, there's more space, so the line comes back. And when it goes to the weight, which is the darker weights on the right side, the line disappears again. So if I wanted to see, this is the result of what I've done. And this is where in the space, which we call design space, this dollar signs sit. So this is my feature variation. So I need to code this kind of corner and say, from this part, you choose the alternative that you, so you alternate the default. So this more or less about the feature variation thinking. And Portada had a weight problem. And that was the weight problem. And the reason that Portada didn't have a thin and a light text weight, it was a conscious decision. Typetogether didn't want to design that. It didn't want to recommend to use thin and light for text weights. So there was no even discussion about adding these extra weights in order to make an easy variable font. So I had to deal with this problem, that there is a gap there. And more or less my design space and variable font formats at the time allows you to have a space like that. So in this space, if I put my masters, which are all my dots, you realize that I have a space there that is dead. So in this space, my design cannot go, shouldn't go. So this is the horizontal line is a display, and is a display sizes. The top one is a text, and this is the optical size. So that means that I don't want to have a display. No, what do I want to have? A text light weight, and I don't want to interpolate text to display in weights that they are not matching. So that was a bit tricky. So I avoided by actually blocking it with extra display masters. But what I want you to understand is what you can have from this font. So I realized that I need to put my Python knowledge together and start doing stuff in Drawbot, because I do really think that animations can make stuff much easier for users to understand where it goes. So this animation to show what are the weights in the text variant. And you see it goes from regular to bold. And this is for the display, which goes a bit thinner than the text. So this is the end zone of display. And of course, this is the optical. You cannot really see the differences, but there is an interpolation between regular text and regular display. So the X height changes and the spacing becomes a bit wider. And this is all my masters together and how they interact. You see, they're just fooling around. And this is more or less what you can get. If you get a Portada variable font, you are going to have all these options and everything between. So you have to remember that when you install this font and you move your slider to go to a very thin weight and the optical size is very big, there's going to be nothing that's going to happen there. It's going to be an empty thing that nothing moves. And this is not a problem with the typeface. This is on purpose. So this is the font I tested in Xpraxis. So you see, I move the optical axis back and forth, the weight too. Everything works fine. And at some point that's going to stop. So this is optical size 14, meaning that the text weight. And I use the loop, which is Lawrence's favorite tool. And I zoom in, and I see that whenever I do, whatever I do with optical size, that doesn't change. Because there's no text optical size in this weight. So that stays exactly the same. So when I go over than 400, which is my regular weights, that's going to alternate. And that's the G that does the funny animations. Was any of that clear? At all? Okay, very good. So because it's not that I didn't trust you, but I know that this is, maybe I don't explain it very well and it's a bit complicated. I prepared something else for you, and hopefully this is going to do the trick. My design space. So the older ones, or the people my age that spend their youth playing Pac-Man, you know that this is a safe place. And the good thing with the variable font, this variable font, is that I have blocked out all the ghosts. So wherever you go, it's safe. Outside in that zone, you're not going to go, and so you enjoy the rest. I think that's it. Yeah, thank you.